Welcome to our Google Plus Hangout.
Hi, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today at our Google Plus Hangout. My name is Marianne Potts, and I'm the editor of the adventure content for NationalGeographic.com. Joining me today are five incredible adventurers. They are some of our National Geographic 2014 Adventurers of the Year, which is supported by Subaru. So let's meet them. Okay, first of all, we've got long-distance swimmer Diana Nyad. Hi, Diana.
Hello, everybody. Happy to be today.
And Diana, where are you today?
I'm in sunny Los Angeles. I shouldn't mention it, but it's 85 degrees today, so I'm very comfortable and warm.
Oh, wonderful. And then next to you, we've got big wave surfer Greg Long. Hi, Greg.
Hi, everyone.
And where are you, Greg?
I'm at home in San Clemente, California.
Awesome. And then continuing down the line, we've got snowboarder Kevin Pearce. Kevin, hi.
Hello. How are you guys? I am in Carlsbad for the day, but I get to go to Denver tomorrow to go snowboarding, so just one day home.
Awesome. Well, so then next we have Kilian Jornet. Kilian, our skyrunner, where are you?
Hello, I'm in Chamonix now.
Oh, wonderful. And the snow is good?
Yeah, it was not snow in the Alps at all, but yesterday it was 60 centimeters fall, so today this morning was awesome.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. And then yeah. Our next person, we've got Sarah Marquis, our solo walker. Sarah, hello.
Hi, how you doing?
Great. And Sarah, where are you?
Well, I'm located in the Swiss Alps in Verbier.
Oh, beautiful. All right, so here we have five of our adventures of the year. But we want to hear from you, too, so please submit your questions to social media, whether that's Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. You can use hashtag ADVofYearChat. And that's all one word, and we will do our best to put your questions into our hangout here. So first of all, we have our Adventures of the Year here. I want to tell you a little bit about what that is. So we have been finding Adventures of the Year here at National Geographic for 9 years. Every year we find 10 amazing, inspiring stories that really showcase what people can do when they follow their dreams and have a great adventure goal. These things can cover exploration, adventure, sports, conservation, field science, but we really want all of the people to be very inspiring and get people to go outside and follow their dreams. So our first question we have comes from Germany, actually. We've got Dagmar Forrester from Lubau, Germany, and on Facebook he posted, "For me, adventure is not to risk your life in order to get a personal kick, but to try to do something new for the sake of mankind." So let's talk about this. What does adventure mean to each of you? And so why don't we start with Diana, who, of course, you probably know she was the first person to swim from Cuba to Florida without a shark cage and a remarkable accomplishment. So Diana, what does adventure mean to you?
And I suppose those words of Dagmar, you know, ring true with me. And when I look down the list of my fellow adventurers today, of whom, by the way, you know, all of you, I'm just in utter awe of what you do. But when he says further the steps of mankind, I think there's something in what we do in tapping potential. Every single person here is doing something very extreme. You know, most people around the planet are not going to be out, you know, as Greg is, on 60 and 70-foot waves. They're literally a handful of human beings alive, you know, who would, you know, have the courage, have the skill, and have the imagination to do that. So I don't think it's sheer ego. I know for me that, you know, this swim from Cuba, yes, it's undeniable. It's an endurance record. It's an endurance accomplishment. It's physical. It's all that. But for me, when I walked up on that shore, I felt that I had spent years, literally 35 years, it started back, that dream, in tapping the unwavering commitment that it would take. So I would imagine that when Kilian looks up that mountain, and, you know, when Sarah starts off on this 2-year solo, you know, hike of this entire planet, that each of you, you know, thinks, I've got to be my best self every minute of every waking day. And when you finish it, it's not so much what you get for it, it's who you become. And so for me, adventuring is tapping that most inner potential. And I do think that the public at large, they read about us and they think, my God, who would ever do that? That's crazy, that's extreme. But the truth is, they extrapolate for their own lives that same feeling of, I want to tap my potential. I want to be engaged. I don't want to just be sitting around on the couch eating Cheetos. I may never ride a 70-foot wave, but I'm going to get out every day and, you know, try to find out who I am in some way. So to me, adventure is potential. It's digging down and becoming everything you can be.
Yeah. So Greg, what do you think? I mean, we put you on our Adventures of the Year list for your remarkable adventure of being this big wave surfer. Of course, there was this dramatic near-drowning incident, but you came back and you really persevered. You brought yourself back to the biggest waves in the world. And so what does adventure mean to you?
Well, Diana touched on it a couple of times. It's relative for every person out there. You know, in our own respective disciplines, this is, you know, our life's, you know, work and what we've, you know, done and accomplished. But you know, it's unique for every single person. And really, what it comes down to, as Diana was saying, was finding your own greatest potential as a human being, physically and mentally. And that was always my, you know, I guess surfing became my avenue of doing that. And, you know, I found my love of the ocean, and, you know, the bigger the wave, the greater the challenge, and it just kind of escalated from there. And really, that's what it comes down to. You know, there's a quote that I always, you know, kind of carry with me, and it's, what the outstanding person does, others will try and do, and the standards that such people create will be followed by the whole world. And, you know, if everybody's out there, you know, with that same mindset of, I just want to, you know, pursue my greatest potential, that's just this perpetual energy that, you know, transcends, you know, sporting disciplines, generations, you know, races, that, you know, you just are inspired by other people. And so that's, you know, what really got me into it. I had a lot of mentors and people that I looked up to that kind of set me off on this path to really pursue, you know, I guess my greatest potential as a surfer, and that, you know, led to, you know, so many other avenues of life. And that's really, you know, what I guess a big driving force of it for me too is, you know, when someone else comes up to me and says, you know, not so much, you know, hey, you're a fantastic surfer, but, you know, I'm just inspired by the way you push yourself. So yeah, that's adventure through and through. It doesn't have to be, you know, the most heroic, you know, record breaking feat, but for one person to just go beyond what they feel like they're capable of doing or thought that they could do and challenge themselves.
Yeah, and I think that's actually a great way to talk to Kevin. So Kevin, you know, you were poised for Olympic glory and had a unexpected accident on the half pipe, which left you with a traumatic brain injury, which you've had to reinvent yourself now. And in terms of exploring your own potential, I mean, that was a big shift for you. What does adventure mean to you?
Yeah, you know, adventure to me, and it did, and it's a lot different now, but I still am adventuring, and I'm still, you know, finding new ways to, you know, define myself and be the person I am. And, you know, to me, it really means to be alive. And before, when I was, you know, doing the competitive snowboarding and I was in that whole, you know, realm of things, you know, I was alive. I was, you know, I was doing, you know, the best I could and working as hard as I could. And it really kind of brought everything out in me. And it was so special to be able to, you know, get those feelings of, you know, competing and, you know, being so successful and then doing so well was just like really kind of lit me up. And I just, you know, it just kind of drove me to be better and better. And it was such an amazing feeling.
Yeah. Well, actually, an amazing feeling. Let's talk to Kilian. Kilian, you are such a prolific mountain athlete. We were totally blown away by lots of things that you do, but in particular, the new speed records on Mont Blanc and the Matterhorn. And you are just able to imagine things in the mountains that most of us think are impossible. What is it that drives you to do that, and how do you see adventure?
I think adventure is, or it's difficult to say after all these people are saying, because it's about that, but I think it's about to go to the unknown, is to go to a thing that you have a lot of possibilities and you need to adapt in the moment. It's Krishnamurti that says that the freedom is to follow no one. So I think adventure is that. It's just to go to one place that you don't know and you know nothing, and just to try to find and to try to explore. I think it can be, you can go to Everest and to have a lot of maps and a lot of things, and and not be in an adventure, and you can go in the background of your home and have adventures because you maybe know you don't know what it will happen. And I think adventuring is about exploring, about discovering, about going to unknowing things and find ways, find emotions, find different things.
Well, yes, and if there's someone who knows about going into the unknown, it's definitely Sarah. Sarah, you walked from Siberia all the way to the southern end of Australia in 3 years. Route unknown, or as tell us about what you think of with adventure and your experience.
Well, for me, adventure has got many definitions, but every step, every day, every moment for me, it's an unknown situation. I'm out of my comfort zone all the time, in every moment of every second. So I think it's this way of dealing with new things, dealing with what's coming at the moment from every direction. And then you use different things from your perspective. See, everything you use normally, it's not that. You use the rest. You dig deep inside you. And I met one day in this trip in Northern Australia an Aboriginal people, and he was on a horse. And he looked at me and said, "You're completely crazy to be out there alone. What are you doing here? You don't have a horse, you've got nothing, you're walking." I said, "Yeah, well, I love it." And he said, "Well, I guess we need some people like you to make the planet spinning." And I like this vision. Yeah. I like his vision. And he was on his horse laughing like a hell. And he just faded, you know, in the horizon. And that was it. I think his words was perfect for that reason. We, each of us here today, we each of us get these things going on in different way, but we all talk about the same thing deep inside our heart.
Well, so I think a lot of people look at your lives and think, oh, you know, I wish that I could do something that I dream about doing, but I'm doing my job. And so we have a question from Andre Sermak of the Czech Republic, who posted on Google+. What did you do in your life before you started to be an adventurer like this, and what made you decide to change? So perhaps, Diana, you've had many different career things. How did you commit to this life of adventure?
You know what? I don't look at this as so separate from everyday life. Like, you know, a good example is now. You know, I did this swim. It was my big epic dream. Back when I was young, in my 20s, I held a number of world records and, you know, swam from the Bahamas to Florida, was the first, you know, woman to swim around Manhattan, and, you know, so that was my sport. But the truth is, if you had met me as a child, there was this personality. There was this person who felt that life is very short, and even as a child I felt that, and that it's a one-way street, and that, you know, all of us get this one chance at 70, 80, 90 years. It's like, you know what the Mary Oliver quote is? She reaches out. She points to all of us and she says, what are you doing with this one wild and precious life of yours? You know, so we can look at each of the one of us and, you know, people from the outside can say, well, you know, those are more wild and more special people than we know, you know, than I am at home. But the truth is, all of us have this in us. All of us, I really love what Kevin said about feeling alive. You don't have to be, you know, a world record holder or doing something no one in the world's ever done to feel alive, you know? So I am never going to swim a long, epic swim in the ocean again. It makes me sad in a way that the journey was so engrossing and it was so uplifting that I'm going to miss that. But that was my dream. And it would be disingenuous, inauthentic of me to make up some other dream, to look at the map and say, oh, I'm going to go swim the Maldives. I'm going to go swim Guam. No, Cuba was my dream, but now it's my job to live that way, to live at that alive, alert sort of status every day, whether it's writing a book, whether it's helping my friend right now get through cancer. It doesn't matter what I do. By the time I get to 90, I want to look back and say it wasn't just the swimmer in me, it was the human being that lived at that alive level every single day.
Wow, yes, that's amazing. And so speaking of being alive, I mean, certainly when you all are out doing your adventures, You're dealing with risks. You're trying to make them into. You're trying to mitigate those risks and dealing with your own fear. So we have a question from Mona Eid from Cairo, Egypt, who asked on Facebook. This is for Kilian. She asks, "How did you become motivated and fearless to do what you do?" So Kilian, can you tell us a little bit about skyrunning and your pursuits in the mountains? And are you afraid when you're up there, or what is going through your head?
Yeah, you need to be afraid, because it's this fear that will make you turn around, and it's really important to turn around sometimes, because we are not, because sometimes we break records, because sometimes we do good things, but if we do these good things, it's because we are all the days, in my case, in the mountains, but it's maybe the 50% of the days that you need to say, okay, now, today the mountain is stronger and you need to turn around. So it's the fear, it's to be afraid that it says, okay, today is not the day, and you need to really listen on that. And I start really young. I start, I has not a possibility to become another thing. I was born in the mountains, and I start mountaineering when I was 1-2 years old, and after that it was really really natural. I think every step with my parents, then with the ski center, with the technification, and I think it really natural. It's for me at 5 years old climbing a summit. It was like a normal day. It was more extreme to go to the city, because it was really an adventure.
Yeah, well, and so Greg, let's chat with you a bit about big wave surfing. So you have described dropping into one of the big waves it's a cliff face that you're surfing into, which it's hard to imagine. It's hard to imagine doing that with just a surfboard and a wetsuit. And how do you approach those big waves? And are you scared?
Yeah, I am, and as Kilian touched on, the fear, it has this negative connotation, that fear or being scared, there's something wrong with it, but it's actually, in my opinion, one of the healthiest emotions that you can feel. It's when you remove yourself from that level of comfort, that's when you're really pushing yourself and exploring what you're capable of.
Yeah. All right. Well, great. So I'm just moving down the line, and guys, feel free to chime in as you feel inclined. But Sarah, so we know that you experienced a lot of challenges while you were out as the solo woman, walking from Siberia all the way to Australia. Tell us about some of the risks and things that you had to overcome while you were doing that walk.
Well. I had problem. My path was going through remote places to start with, so that was my thing, to go through desert area. But then there is people there still, like in Mongolia, especially in the northern part. I had those really fun, nice horsemen decide to be to start to scare me at night. So the night was slowly getting in. The day was the end of the day. My tent was set up, I had my meal, and I start to sleep, and that's where they start to come in my camp. So they're completely drunk, 5 or 6 of them, every night for six weeks, 7 weeks. And finally, I decided that was enough, I need to find a solution. And I find a way to avoid them. It was to sleep under the road, on those sewage pipe, those big concrete tubes. And I was sneaking in, and start to set up my camp inside as much as I can, and that was like a palace for me. It was unbelievable. Yeah. I was safe there. But then I had in Laos, I had the drug dealer situation with machine gun, like in a movie. It was unbelievable, and then that never really stopped. I had problem all the way with humankind, but every time I was with nature, that was sandstorm. That was big, huge storm. I lose my tent many times on the way, but nature, it's always something that I can read in certain extent. Human, it's another thing. It's different.
Well, and we know you spent 1,000 nights in a tent, and were there times where you were like, I'm done with this. I am so tired of this tent. I'm not going to Australia. And how did you deal with that?
Well, we talked with Diane about it just before we start this hangout. It was interesting, actually, because it's all about the moment. You've got a period of 6 months where everything's painful. Your body, every inch in your body is painful. And 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, I say it's a wash machine process. So you're inside a wash machine all the time. And after 6 months, you wake up one morning and you don't have pain anymore. It's sunshine all over. And that's where the fun begins. So then you've got this amazing atmosphere about with nature, this harmony, getting this connection, this deep connection with nature. And you then finally look back and say, I'm here where I want to be. And that's the moment where everything starts. And then you know from that day, everything's going to be fine, whatever happened.
Well, and so Kilian, for you, I mean, you're also out on these long treks along the land. Are you feeling a harmony with nature while you're speeding up the mountain and speeding down?
Yeah, if we are there, it's because we feel the nature, and it's about that, I think. Or I grew up in a place where it was not many people around, so for me to feel alive, it's being in the nature. And of course, when you are speeding up and you are doing a record, when you are in the moment of the thing, maybe you are more concentrated about the thing that you are doing. But during all the trainings, during all the time that you spend to prepare the things, it's just to be there. It's a lot of times that you say, okay, I will training, and it's not a real training. It's to be out and to feel everything around, to feel just to be in the place that you want. It gives you some energy.
Yeah, well, so let's kind of compare that to Kevin, to your experience. We had a question on Facebook from Mar Castillo, who says, Kevin, you've had such an empowering story that encourages people to never stop believing. What holds you together and what keeps you moving forward? I mean, we know that you went from top athlete to having to relearn how to do most things in your life. What has kept you going to get through all of those challenges?
It's kind of who I am, and I've never been the person to kind of, you know, sit back and say, okay, I'm good enough here. And that's how it was when I was, you know, snowboarding and, you know, at the prime of my, you know, adventuring that I was doing. And, you know, being so successful at snowboarding was because, you know, I was very determined and I was very focused and, you know, I was very concentrating on being the best at that. And, you know, it's kind of transformed over into this recovery. And, you know, I've had to, like you said, relearn how to do everything. We have video footage of, you know, the doctors teaching me how to swallow again and, you know, to walk and to talk and all of these things. And just, like, it's been, you know, that same mentality that I've taken from snowboarding that has, you know, allowed me to, you know, recover from this and come back. And it's been a long, hard, slow process, and my brain is still healing and it's still getting better. But because I've been able, you know, to focus all the energy in, you know, the right positive way, and, you know, I have it right here, as I've been able to love my brain and, you know, love this new person that I am, it's, you know, allowed me to make this all possible.
Yeah. Well, speaking of having to persevere, Diana, we know that you had to, you tried the Cuba to Florida swim 4 times over 35 years before getting it done. What was it that made you willing to put yourself out there again in front of all the world to see, and how did you approach that to motivate yourself?
You know, the failures were crushing. It's, you know, you put together this expedition. The training is it's grueling. It's just so many countless 12 and 16 and 20 hour swims, longer swims than most marathon swimmers ever do once in their entire lives. So, you know, to fail and fail publicly, each one was, you know, kind of a big deal. And frankly, by this fifth time, 2013, my colleagues in marathon swimming, my best friends on my team, the world experts of the jellyfish, the sharks, the currents, the public in general, the media said to me, you know, go ahead, it's valiant. If you've still got it in your heart and you're willing to fail again, but We're not going to be there. If you make it to the shore, we'll be there. But we're not going across with you again. We've just put too many resources. We've put our heart and soul into it, and we just don't believe it anymore. And I think that, you know, I wanted to sort of address what all of us had spoken about earlier, which is fear. You know, Kilian said it well, is that, you know, you go up that mountain and, you know, you're not conquering the mountain. You're at one with it. And if on any given day, the mountain speaks to you and says, this isn't your day. You know, you shouldn't be up there. And I'm sure that Greg has that feeling. He knows the wave that is not the wave. You know, we're all in the heart of Mother Nature, and Mother Nature is bigger than all of us. But I believe in this swim. I believed, and I never lost faith, no matter how difficult it was, no matter how painful it was to put it back together. I had a vision of walking up on that shore, and I never lost sight of that vision. You know, this last year, I don't know if you guys know it, you probably do, and I won't quote it exactly, but the paraphrase of Teddy Roosevelt's quote was, you go ahead. You go ahead and be the critic, and you sit in your comfortable chair, and you analyze and criticize the people who are going to get in the ring. But me, I want to be the guy in the ring. I want to be the guy who gets bloodied and dirtied and fails over and over and over again, but at least I'm not timid. I'm bold, and yeah. I'm going to live out my life. I'm going to live it out loud. And
awesome.
That's the person I wanted to be when I walked up on that shore.
That is so inspiring, and I think we all can relate to that. So I just want to also remind folks, please do send in your questions via social media, Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Use hashtag ADV of Year Chat, and we will try to get them in. So I have a question for Sarah here. We've got Anand Nande posted on Google+. What do you consider the most important thing while packing your bags for adventure? I mean, we know you had to bring your stuff with you, so you're probably pretty much an expert at this point.
Yeah, well, actually, you don't need much. You realize then at the end of the day, you don't need much. When you get out there like that, it's 2 years preparation. It's 2 full-year preparation, thinking, what in this temperature? I've been in Mongolia in a desert by minus 45 degrees Celsius. I've been in the jungle with another type of gear, and every time there is different gear, different technology, different material, different shoes even. And then I need to do the same thing than everybody. I need to think ahead, anticipation. I'm thinking, well, I'm going to have this type of temperature. I'm going to have humidity. What kind of sleeping bag I will need? And you need to ask yourself questions. But I will never go anywhere without my teapot.
With your teapot? Oh, really?
Yeah. Ah. The teapot, it's my little philosopher with me, you know?
When
everything goes wrong, when you've got a crap day from the first minute you open your tent, well, don't do anything else. Just I make a little fire with 2 sticks. If I've got enough water, I just put my teapot on the top of it, have a tea, and then look around, and so then you go.
Well, and Kilian, Kilian, I'm sure you don't bring a teapot with you, but you do probably plan very carefully the what you will take. I mean, we know when you're running up the mountain, you're not taking all the standard mountaineering gear, but what do you bring with you?
It really depends. I don't like to take weight. I like to move fast. So it's sometimes you need to have a compromise, and it's this compromise: how uncomfortable you want to feel, or how cold you want to feel to go fast, and it's about that. So I try to take the minimum. For climbing Mont Blanc or Matterhorn, you just need shorts and running shoes. Then if it's you go to a colder place, maybe gloves or if it's some ice climbing, just ice access. So it's always thinking about the road that you will go and try to take the minimum. And it's a lot of times that you say, oh, I cannot go farther because I didn't bring it. Sometimes it has been some nice solutions like taking just a boot and try to make a ice axe with and just climbing with a with a part of a tree or things like that that you need to invent.
Yeah.
But normally just try to be as light.
Oh, sure. And I'm glad to hear that sometimes you turn around because you don't have the, if the storm's coming in and you're not, you don't have that heavy jacket that you turn around.
Yeah.
It's a good time to turn around. So Kevin, we have a question for you. This is from Google Plus. We have Mickey Meyer who says, where do you see yourself when you turn 50?
Oh,
God. What a question.
What a
you've had
question.
Two lives already.
Yeah, 26 now, 50. Yeah, I guess, you know, I don't see myself when I'm 50. I've learned very much that you need to live every day in the present moment, and really kind of that's the most important thing, is to live in the now and to live here and not, you know, I'm not thinking about, you know, where I'm going to be when I'm 50. You know, I came so close to dying that, you know, if I make it to 50, I think that'll be unbelievable. So I'm going to, you know, do everything I can and, you know, try and be as safe as possible and, you know, still live a really cool, fun, exciting life, but in a smart, safe way, and really just kind of do everything I can to, you know, be focused on the now and the present.
Do you think I could ask a question of Kevin?
Absolutely.
Kevin, I bet you anything, I know I felt this when I watched your video and saw you read about your story, is that I bet you there are a lot of people in this world who, once they become the best there is, which is what you were, that to have an accident, to have something that's not fair, that's, you know, it's not planned. What do they say? Life happens when plan B comes along. There are a lot of people in your situation who would become depressed, become bitter, and never want to go near that world again and go down. So what is it about you? Do you think that that is just your spirit? Is that your, if we knew you as a little boy, were you the kid that was always going to find the positive? Or did you have people around you who helped mentor you through this to find the obvious joy that you feel today? You're not a bitter kid. You're a joyful kid. How did you get there?
Yeah, you know, it's crazy to hear that and to hear, you know, how people can go through this and, you know, they just get so sad and they get so depressed and they feel so bad for themselves. And, you know, it's just so crazy to me because for me this whole time and through this whole recovery, I've taken the total opposite path, and you know, I've gone at it in such a different way, and you know, I've kind of tried to do everything I can to look at, you know, this in a positive way and look at all the things that are so great and, you know, everything about how lucky I am and how well everything's gone. And you know, I would have to say that a huge reason for that is, you know, definitely one is because that's the type of kid I am, and two, because of the family I have. I have three older brothers. The one just older than me, David, has Down syndrome. In this film that just came out, The Crash Reel, actually on iTunes just came out yesterday, it talks about, is a huge role of David and about how we call it up syndrome and, you know, how he's an up kind of kid. And it's so amazing just to have this family have, you know, supported me and showed me how this, you know, can be turned into a positive and about how so many good things can come from this and, you know, that it's not, you know, obviously severe traumatic brain injuries are, you know, very intense, and for a long time there was, you know, very, you know, questionable if I was going to live or die. And, you know, now that I am alive and doing so well, I'm just kind of so happy and so, you know, it's just incredible what's been able to happen with this.
Well, and I think happiness is something we definitely want to touch on. I mean, I know people are drawn to the risk and fear part of all this, but certainly you all are out pushing your boundaries and exploring your limits for the rewards of it. And we have a question from Sebastian Nalen from Melbourne, who asked on Google Plus, what was not your biggest achievement but your happiest moment while undertaking your adventures? I'm just going to let whoever wants to answer first on that jump in. Or suggest Sarah.
Yeah. Well, for me, my little lighting incredible moment, it's always with nature. Mm-hmm. Always. And it's sometimes like in a Gobi, I'm in my tent and in my sleeping bag, it's warm, it's all cozy, and suddenly I hear and I'm like wondering, what is this noise? My God, what's going on? And I open my tent, and I just sneak out, and just, there is no noise around. And then I see this camel coming through, this baby camel, and the mom and the dad and everybody, and they're just around me. And it is such an unbelievable feeling just to be part of them. And then you just realize you're part of this universe and you're part of this nature thing. This is how we're supposed to be, all linked together, nature, animals, us. And it's exactly the picture you see now. It's exactly that moment. And it's just unbelievable. For me, it's worth to go for 3 years like that, through all that, just for this moment of connection and harmony. And I had the same with the wolf. I had the same with the bear. I had the same with all these dangerous animals, which they are not. Most of the time, it's how you are as a human being in the middle of this nature. If you're part of it naturally, that would just be an amazing experience.
Well, let's talk about dangerous
animals. You know, if I could, Marianne.
Yeah, absolutely.
If I could, I want to echo exactly what Sarah's talking about there, and that is that, you know, we can go all the way back to the Greeks, and the issue, the debate of is it the journey or is it the destination, you know, comes up. So almost all of us here, we want the destination. You know, Sarah wants to get to the end of that long trail, and she did it. You know, she hiked under her own steam and her own bravery and her own intelligence for 2 years around the globe to get to that, you know, end point, and she's going to do more and more of those. For me, I wanted to get to that shore, but the truth is the memories I have are the nature to swim at night and look up. You know, you're out 60 miles from shore, and you didn't take a boat there. You swam there under your own power. And your team is with you, and to look up at the stars and say to someone on board, isn't it freaky that we're not really seeing those stars? That is the trail of light that is still traveling for, you know, hundreds of thousands of light years to reach us, but those stars have gone. They've evaporated. They're not in that place anymore. So those moments, whether it be with the animals or with, you know, with our blue planet of ours, that's what I remember. I don't, you know, wake up at night saying, yeah, well, I was the one who walked up on the shore. I remember the moments with my team and with Mother Earth.
But Diana, I do have to ask, we all know that there were sharks around you, you had jellyfish. I mean, tell us a little bit about just being around what we all consider undesirable company.
Yeah, well, when you're out there, you're in territory that is not your own. You know, it's just like when Sarah comes across a wolf, that's the wolf's habitat, and we're not there to conquer them, kill them, you know, anything like that. So these, in this particular water, the Cuban waters, these are the most dangerous sharks in the world, the oceanic white tips, the lemons, the tigers, these are the most venomous animals in the world, the box jellyfish. But similar to the way Kilian was talking about, you know, you understand your environment and you're intelligent. As Sarah said, every expedition of hers is a discovery of technology, of nature, and every time I've been out in the ocean, my team and I, they're the experts in the world at every phase, at the Gulf Stream, at the eddies in the Gulf Stream, at those particular jellyfish, and how to possibly develop a prosthetic mask that I could wear to not be stung. So the level of discovery is exciting. And, you know, it's sort of all the list of obstacles that we could come across, I'm never going to be bigger than any of them, but it doesn't mean that we can't be intelligent and planning and understand how to possibly create some luck to get through them and get to the other side. It's thrilling. The discovery is absolutely thrilling.
Well, and Kilian, do you think there's luck involved in how quickly you're able to do your ascents?
I think it's luck. I think the luck. It's always there, and it's just to try to do the best to find it. It's if you dream, you will put things or you will be motivated, and you will do things to become. It's like sport. It's if you want to win a race, you need to train, and you need to lose a lot and to have bad moments, and at the end you will have luck and you will win, but this luck you try to find. So I think it's a lot on that, it's try to finding. And then, yeah, of course we are in the nature, we are not in a place where all is stable and we need just to push, we need to have luck or to spend time in the nature to find a good moment.
Well, and so now, Kevin, for you these days, what are your happiest moments as a snowboarder and part of the snowboarding community?
Being in the snow. I have I've been so lucky this year, and I just got to spend pretty much the entire month of December up in Baldface, Canada, which is a snowcat operation, and just riding powder, and they just have a ton of snow up there, and it's the most special place I've ever been to in my entire life. And then I just, day before yesterday, I was in Utah, and there was a ton of snow there, and I was back in Vermont with my amazing family, and it's snowing there. So I've got to spend a lot of time in the snow. So being down here in Southern California is a little bit different for me, because it's really warm, and no snow down here. But.
Well, and Kevin, how do you approach snowboarding now? We know you're not doing major tricks on the half pipe, but what are you doing in snowboarding?
I'm really just enjoying it and just being so, you know, so thankful and so happy that I'm able to do it, and, you know, that I've been able to have such a, you know, successful recovery, and, you know, that I'm even able to get out there, and, you know, I've really kind of learned to, you know, really to take, you know, really each moment in life, and really kind of, before it was like I was going so fast and not able to really understand what I have, but now I'm just so thankful for all the, you know, the little things that I'm able to do and able to have now. So it's really changed.
Hey, well, Kevin, I wondered if I could ask you another question, and I hope this doesn't seem too rude, but I know that all of us have read about you, and we want to ask this question, and I really mean it in a purely medical way. And that is, so we read that you've had a traumatic brain injury. You just minutes ago that your brain is still healing. So help us understand what that means. What happened to your brain? What's going on in there? And you know, how is it how has it affected you day to day? And will you be back to what your brain was a few years ago?
Yeah, you know, the brain's crazy. It's so wild, you know, how complicated and how much is going on in each inside of each one of our brains. And, you know, to be completely honest with you, I don't know as much as I should about exactly what happened to my brain. I do know that when I hit the snow and slammed my head, that my brain bounced in my skull and hit the other side of my head, and, you know, it bruised the brain, and so that caused swelling where my brain kind of started getting bigger, and they had to drill into my head to allow the swelling to happen. And, you know, there was kind of a lot of different stuff going on there at the beginning, and it the brain's wild because of how long and how slow it likes to heal, and how, you know, it's been 4 years now, and, you know, it's still healing and it's still getting better, and, you know, it's really hard to deal with something that takes that long. It's like there's nothing else that you can do. You know, if you break a bone, it heals and it gets better. If you break a brain, it doesn't just heal. It takes a long time for that to happen.
Well, and I feel like we need to talk about snow sports for a second. And and actually, everyone, please feel free to continue to submit questions to social media at hashtag ADV of Year Chat. But Kevin, we got this question from Laurie Christian Sherwood, who posted on Facebook. Do you think it's possible to create a helmet or padding that may improve the level of safety for snow sports? And of course, we're in the middle of skiing and snowboarding season. We've had a high-profile injury of a Formula One race car driver. What do you think about helmets and snow sports and the future for protecting people?
Yeah, actually, that's so interesting you bring that up, because that's been a big focus of mine. And actually, one of the trips I was just on was to Pennsylvania, and we went and met with this company called Unequal Technologies, and it's this technology that they've created where you put this, I don't have one with me, but you put this padding and you just place it inside your helmet, or they're kind of developing it for all different parts of the body, but you can just put this, you know, it's really simple padding in your helmet, and it makes your helmet like two or three times as safe. And it's just like this, You know, it's like this carbon fiber technology that's just incredible. And I think, you know, the future is, you know, that's the future, and it's really wide open of, you know, there's so much more that can be created to, you know, cause these helmets and these protective gears to be much safer. So, you know, us athletes are able to do these sports in a much safer and, you know, a way that it's not as dangerous, and, you know, things are, you know, less risky for us.
Yeah.
So the unequal technology is kind of, I think, the next step to this, you know, future of safety.
Okay, great. Well, so we are getting close to the end of our time, so if you have any final questions out there, please do submit them. One question that is pretty fun that we got from Ross Meredith on Google Plus says, this is actually directed to all of you, but if you weren't out exploring and risking your life in the pursuit of your happiness, and also while we watch in awe, is there something else you would be doing? Or are you doing what you would do? Is there anything else that you can imagine doing?
Yeah.
Well,
I think many, many things, but you can dream about a lot of things. Maybe for me now, it's being in the mountains, it's exploring, but it's everything in the life. I think the important thing is keep dreaming, is to have dreams and just enjoy the day after. It's a dream, and probably for my background, it's the mountains, because it's the thing that I was eating when I was kid. But it's just being in connection with the nature, and you can connect them like in the sea, in the mountains, in the deserts, everywhere. But you just try to have this connection and try to have drinks and to try to find the happiness in every day.
Well, and Kilian, we just got a new question for you. This is from RJ Jaganio on Google Plus. He says, Kilian, what do you think about when you're running trail ultra marathons?
In long distance, I think it's the same with Sarah, that after a lot of hours I have been running non-stop for more than 40, 45, 48 hours, and you try to disconnect and think in other things. If you are concentrated just with the movement, you can be concentrated for some hours, but then you are bored. And you try to just enjoy the nature, and then you can use different techniques, or listen music, or in the last long race I do, I was listening a book, so it was pretty fun. Maybe it was not the good book, but you try to think on different things and just to spend time. So it's good when you race with someone that you can talk with.
Can you listen to a whole book during one of your longer races?
Yeah, sure. It was this last long race, it was a 30-some-hour race, so it was just one book.
Oh, wow.
You know, our team kept making jokes that what I would do was listen to War and Peace as I went across from Cuba, and just as I got to the shore, there were only two chapters to go. And I said, no, we can't read the shore yet. I gotta listen to those last two chapters. So we did an extra little circle. So, but I tell you, for me, what thrills me about life is stories. Reading stories, watching stories, all the people on this panel today. I mean, each one is a life story, and the way they talk about it and the details of their lives, it's riveting. And I fancy myself a storyteller. So I'm writing a book this year. I've written a few before, but this year my goal is to, you know, not just tell my story, but all these people I've been lucky enough to meet in my life. And I want to do a one-woman show. I want to get on stage and tell dramatic stories and funny stories. And just every person on this earth has a story. Now, it turns out that these particular people, you know, Sarah and Greg and Kevin and Kilian, you have extraordinary stories, but every human being has a story, and I love to hear them, and I love to tell them. That's my thing, storytelling.
Absolutely, and thank you all for your stories. I think it came up once before, but one question we got was about are there any mantras that kind of give you the motivation you need when you're feeling like you might give up on something? Is there a short phrase that you think of that kind of carries you through?
Mine's find a way. You know, it's so simple. I'm not the only one who's ever said it. You know, you can turn on any NFL game every weekend, and every announcer says that the San Diego Chargers have got to find a way to stop that guy. But for me, whether it's things that you expect and you just know are going to be out there, or the total unknown that shocks you and sends your system into, you know, desperate measures for a minute, you just stop and say, find a way. And it goes for people going through divorce or people just wanting to get out of a profession they don't want to be in. You've got to sit down and say, I know where I want to go, and somehow I'm going to find a way to get there.
And what about you, Kevin? Is there something that's kind of gotten you through the harder parts of this recovery?
My family. Yeah. It's been really hard to get through this, and it's taken a long time to figure out what's gonna happen, and that's kind of where I'm at now, is figuring out what's next for me now that I can't, you just asked what we'd be doing if we can't be doing our sport anymore, and I can't be doing my snowboarding competitively anymore, and it's been really difficult, and I've kind of tried to channel all this energy and all of this, all of these resources I've had into this love movement. And this is, it's for me, it's helping, and that's what I want to do now, is to help and support and to give back. And I've gotten so much, and I've just learned after sustaining this injury how many people in this world that we're living with are going through something very seriously, and whatever it is, if they're suffering, if they're struggling, anything, it's like there's so many people that need help. And so I found that, with this, just by selling these shirts and then these bowls and these stickers and these different things on my website, that I've been able to really help people and give back. And that has been, so amazing for me, is to be able to feel, what it's like to be able to really do something good.
That's amazing. And I guess I should just add that we lost Greg, unfortunately. His connection cut him out, but I'm glad we got a few questions with him before he had to, before he was cut out. I guess, Sarah, do you have a mantra or anything that when you're being held hostage in Laos, you think, this is going to get me through?
Yeah, well, I'm not like all the other guys, actually, because my journey go through silence. I don't have music, I don't have books with me. And I go through every single day with the noise of nature around me. I don't use any device where that will disturb that, because I feel it's a disturbance for me. It is not helping me at all. I need to listen every little things around. And more I walk, more I get sensitive. I've got my hearing system getting better. My feeling, my smell, I can smell, in a Gobi I smell a tourist for far away, I can smell shampoo from her hair. It's unbelievable. You go back to your animals, your little animals part, your mammal part. From each of us got this. We are half animals, half human. So depends where you want to be. So I used to switch from that side to the other side, and I cross this little bridge. And when I walk, I become like this wild part of version of myself and get the link with nature. But when everything goes wrong, that's not true words. The words for me, it's only words sometimes. It's not linking with something. It's human. Human make words, but you need more than that. You need energy. And when things go really wrong and I need to take a decision, well, I sleep.
That's a good
one. I put my tent, I get inside my sleeping bag, my best friend, and I sleep. And then I make the decision. And then for sure it's a good decision.
So we're probably down to our last question. So I wanted to give you all an opportunity to tell us about what you're up to next. And I know we've talked a little bit about how after a big life adventure, people want to know what's next, and sometimes you need some time to really kind of appreciate and all of the things that you learned on your big quest. But other things coming up next. I think, Kevin, are you headed to Sochi?
Yeah, well, I got a, I was going to say, you know, next for me is, you know, first and foremost, spreading the love. But, you know, immediately what's next for me is tomorrow I go to Denver, and I've been doing public speaking and, you know, spreading this message of head injuries and what's possible and how, you know, full recoveries are possible from it. And then, so I'm going to go do that in Denver tomorrow. And then I'm actually just working now on trying to get a flight to Sochi to go and carry the torch for the opening ceremony. So I'm very excited about that. I've never actually been, thank you, I've never actually been to the Olympics before. So I think it's going to be amazing to get to go experience that. And then I'm going to try and continue to snowboard in a safe, fun way as much as I can this winter.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Kilian, what are you up to next? And I didn't mean to skip you on the mantra. Is there some sort of mantra that keeps you going?
Or mantras, I think they are, but it's more, I think, just every day I keep going. Is that? And the next is first tomorrow. I think it's tomorrow, look in the window, see the mountains, and well, it looks nice to go. And then there are some projects too. This year we start the World Cup next week, ski mountaineering, and then for the big mountains we want to go in June to McKinley, and then we want to have fun and to do nice things if we can.
Great. Sarah, how about you? What's next?
Well, I'm finishing my book. It's like a horrible experience because I need to stay put inside and write, but I finally get through it, and I'm happy about that because I did write it myself. I read a few books before, and I'm happy it's over, and then I can go walking again, and I get ready for next year. Next year I would let you know what's going on. There is something on next year. It's going to be exciting.
Oh, we can't wait to hear. And Diana, yeah. What is your focus these days?
Sarah, I so look forward to reading your book. As I mentioned before, I am writing a memoir at the moment too, so it's engrossing, and I'm you know, disciplined and into it every day, just like training. But I will say that as shallow as it's going to seem to this whole group, I really want to do Dancing with the Stars. So I'm right now sort of in my living room learning to do a little tango and cha-cha. And I haven't been invited yet, but if I do, I'll be doing Dancing with the Stars in the spring.
Well, that's excellent. Awesome. Well, thank you, everyone, and thank you, everyone online, for joining us for this wonderful Hangout. Very inspiring, and you all have such different stories to share. That really relate to each other, though, and it feels like a very special moment to have you all together on this Hangout. We have additional adventures of the year, so you can read all of their stories about these five plus the others, and be sure to cast a vote for the People's Choice Adventure of the Year, which you can do until the end of the month. But thank you so much to everyone for joining us today. And we are going to keep covering your stories, so keep us informed, and we will share your stories with everyone out there. So thanks so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks.